You are listening to the Pencil and Paper Podcast Network.
Welcome back to Super Mega Crash Beyond. I am your host, Stephen White. With me, as always, is my co-host, Lacey Upendley.
Happy Monday.
I hope everyone is surviving this heat wave.
Because I know.
I can only imagine by the time people are listening to this how hot it's gotten.
Because, or we're back to winter.
Yeah, because, I mean, hell, it could have just shifted somewhere, and it's like, you know what? The hell with this heat. We're going back to wintertime.
Right, yeah.
It was like, but it's only August. What are you...
I don't care. Mother Nature's like, you guys are screwing me up. I'm going to throw fits all year long.
But, yeah, it's... Oh, God, I tried, okay? Because yesterday, I usually do some of my yard work on the weekends, and I'd been kind of gauging the weather and everything, and I was like, it's been really hot. It hasn't rained, finally, for a long stretch of time. Yeah. So I'm kind of glad about that, but then I'm also looking at my yard, and it's just like, help me! Like, it's trying to grow.
Burning to death.
Yeah, and it's just like, give me water. So I took, I was like, you know what? I'm not going to mow it, because it doesn't look like it's overgrown. Mm-hmm. It looks like it's struggling real hard, so I don't want to give it anything else to do, and it's hot. So I was like, you know what? I'll let it grow a little bit more. And then when the rain will come in this week or whatever, maybe it'll kind of spruce it up. And then I can go mow it and then it'll be fine. Well, in the meantime, I should have just taken the opportunity to sit down and do nothing. But I got antsy. What happened is that I was supposed to do something. And everything went out the window. You know what I mean? So I'm just like, well, shit. You know, I was already prepared for something, then it just kind of disappeared. So I was just like, all right, well, now I'm antsy. Now, what do I do? And Katrina's like, sit down. Just relax. And I'm like, but the energy's already there. Like, somebody's already wound my clock.
Needs something.
Yeah. So I was like, all right, you know what? I've already decided I'm not going to mow the lawn. I'll just go outside and do some yard work, little things that I've been holding off on because I haven't had the time.
Uh-huh.
And I go out there for an hour and I have to come back in because the heat is keeping me from breathing.
Yeah.
You know, like,
yeah,
I could barely breathe.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, Jesus Christ. And just within an hour, I'm soaking wet. I'm struggling to breathe. And I'm like, this is terrible. What the hell?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I hated it. So,
yeah.
Jesus Christ.
We've even had it stifling hot here as well. It was just interesting because we were all like, my God, is it ever going to get summer? And then the next day it's like, oh, did you want 100 and humid? Fuck you then. And I'm like, okay, all right. Sorry.
The humid
part.
We
were just saying it was June and you were still in the 50s. So we were just kind of wondering and then bam, like, okay.
Hmm.
I'll keep my mouth shut. Mother Nature, clearly, you know, but yeah, we did get some rain though. So today, or at least I should just say this morning, felt fairly nice. We'll see how the day shapes up as it goes along.
Yeah. But, again, I hope everyone's surviving, getting through it.
Yes. Keep cool.
Safely. Yeah. Because Jesus Christ, man, it's terrible.
Yeah.
In the biggest non sequitur in history.
All right.
let's move on to our topic today. I think we both kind of agreed on wanting to talk about this because we both saw the trailer and was like, should we? And I was like, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we should do that.
So we're talking about the documentary that dropped on Hulu a few weeks back called Brats. If you're unfamiliar with the Brat Pack, this was we'll kind of break this down as we go along, a selection of actors who were kind of lumped into this group. Because of a lot of things, I guess.
Well, they were in a lot of movies together, I guess.
Yeah.
Or like John Hughes, probably specifically, like they all worked for him in a the same time frame, yeah. I guess, you know, that few years when it was just like really booming for young adult movies, you know.
And it also, it's kind of goes through what that moniker meant for them going forward.
I learned a lot.
I did too. That's the one thing I wanted to kind of really focus on up front is my understanding. Like, I heard this term, I'm sure like you, from the moment I was familiar with these movies or anything like that, I heard that term.
Yeah, Brat Pack. Used it.
Yeah.
Yep.
And I thought...
That's what they were.
I thought, oh, that's like some fancy little moniker, some little nickname for this little group of friends. Mm-hmm. And that's cool, man. You know, they're the Brat. They're the Brat Pack. Uh-huh. They're the cool kids. You
kind
know,
of making a play on the Rat Pack or something like that. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, and that specifically, the Rat Pack to the Brat Pack, is why I was under the assumption this was a cool thing. This was just their thing. They were just like, yeah, we're owning it, baby. We're the Brat Pack, baby. We, you know, we're the cool kids of Hollywood.
Well, everyone thought so, but...
That's what I thought.
Yeah.
And to find out that it affected them in such a way and negatively...
Yeah, negatively.
Blew my mind.
Me too. Like, when he first said it, I was just like, oh my God. And now I felt kind of guilty for, like, using it so... But I mean, I knew no better, and I was still, I mean, I was still too young to really understand when their movies and stuff were coming out, you know, like 81, 82, 83 to 85 or whatever. It's just like, I was like a couple of years, maybe at best old, like no idea. So by the time I was familiar with them, you know, I don't know that I don't even know that I really knew it came from an article from some random journalist.
That I didn't know. Yeah, I think... I would probably admit this is the first I remember hearing about it.
Yeah. I don't think I ever knew how the term was, you know, or how the it was coined. Is that the word I'm looking
for? Yeah, yeah.
How the phrase was coined.
I mean, it does seem like something, obviously, if we kind of deduced it in our heads before this, we could have been like, well, it had to have been like something someone said or just a dropped quote somewhere. And then it just caught like wildfire, which it did.
Which it did, yeah.
But yeah, a very specific, like all the details spawning from that article are details I didn't know. So
yeah,
it wasn't even meant to be about the entire group. It was supposed to be like a piece on Emilio Estevez that then ballooned into this thing and used the term Brat Pack because the guy thought it would be amusing.
Yeah.
And so many people did too. I mean, there was that small conversation he had with, I guess I should preface this too, Andrew McCarthy, one of the people who
He was the one doing it.
Yes.
It was him and his production company, which I didn't know he really had, but he was the one who decided, I want to see if I can get a... He hadn't talked to him. And that was another thing. People are like, oh, they're just best friends. They're hanging out all the time. And they're like, we've done movies together, but like... That was the last I saw of so-and-so, you know? So when he's even saying, I don't even have so-and-so's number, and it's been like 30 years later, you're like, wow, like they really just shared something, just this random thing, but they weren't even like super close friends or anything, you know, but this one term just kind of binds them for life.
Sure.
It was just really, it was really interesting to hear because I like Andrew McCarthy.
Oh, yeah.
And it kind of broke my heart to find out that it just like haunted him so terribly. And to hear him explain it makes kind of, you know, makes sense that, you know, if it was certain roles that were getting denied to them because now they had this stigma of just being like these bratty kids who didn't take the art seriously or anything like that. They're like, no, we're all like real trained actors that just happened to get lucky in a perfect time in cinema where it was catering to people of their age. And they even mentioned it was the only time in history you could really see that, where young adults had movies seeing themselves as the stars, as the protagonists, the main focus. It wasn't always just adult love stories and all this stuff. So
which
this is a really cool time, you know,
which I had never ever considered. Like,
I didn't either.
I consider myself somewhat of a movie buff and movie history buff. You know, I love hearing a lot of stories of old Hollywood and things like that. But that one little detail, it's clear when you kind of look back on it now. It's like, you're right. Yeah. Because you go back to the 70s. 70s are like a grimy crime story, cop story, kind of. That seems to be the
very serials, like
like there was a very sensible or a sense of direction on what the messaging was, and then that's what a lot of those movies were. And then of course, once at the end of the decade or close to the end, Star Wars kind of shifts focus and it's like, wait a second, we can do this other thing. You know, it doesn't have to be dark and moody and on shit all the time. But the teen thing. Like, at what point did that just really hit and just trigger something? And I think he mentioned, I don't remember the movie, but he mentioned something about Timothy Hutton and a movie he did, and he won an Academy Award.
Was it St. Elmo's Fire?
No, this was, he did something separate, and I feel like the movie, I can't remember, because even his name, I had to remember it. But as soon as I saw him, I was like, oh, yeah, I remember that dude.
Oh, shoot. He's done a lot.
Yeah. But he apparently, like, they kind of pinpointed it as that moment where he won that Oscar for whatever the movie was.
Oh, yeah.
Seemed to be, like, the on the cusp of saying, hey, these young kids, they can be stars, too.
And they're good. Look at that. Yeah.
And what's interesting about that as well is...
Was it Ordinary People?
Yes, yes, that was it. Ordinary People. And what's interesting about that, too, is I'm coupling that with a completely different conversation, but it's funny to take two different perceptions of something and then just... There's a truth there.
Yeah.
I think... it was Ron Howard. That's who he was talking about. Because he was talking about child actors in Hollywood. And how they were... Those characters are written, how they were perceived. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, at that time when he was growing up, Ron Howard, as, you know, doing Opie and even to some extent.
Happy Days?
What the fuck is his character name? We'll get there. Richie.
In what?
Richie.
Oh.
Richie Cunningham. Ah. Mm-hmm. He said that the kids were normally written as like the smart ass little kids, where it's just like, well, that's just... Like, they're smarter than everybody else in the room, and everybody else is an idiot.
Just bratty teenagers, yeah.
And he said they were written in such a way that they all kind of had that, well, that's just, that's not right. And it just continued, I mean, even to the 80s.
Like a stereotype, I guess. You know, just like, teenagers are dumb, stupid humans, and they're just going to be the complication for this scene or something that makes you roll your eyes till the adults can take it back over or something. You know?
And it's just funny having that. Because I never thought about that either, but I was like, fuck yeah, you're right. So if you take a look at a lot of the kids in a lot of these movies for at least what?
I would even argue to some extent today.
To some extent, yeah. They're bringing it back some.
Yeah. That nothing shuts me off quicker than just like instantly turning it into like some teenage angst. Blah, I know more and you're stupid. It's like, can we come up with better plot points yet?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, no. We're remaking movies from 40 years ago. Never mind. We can't continue. But yeah.
So you have these child characters who are being that. And then, of course... Now they're trying to bring in something new, or someone tries doing something new. And it's funny that that's the kind of thing that catches on. It's like Hollywood's like, hey, let's try this or let's try that. And it kind of makes me wonder if there wasn't some, like, John Hughes obviously seemed to be the person that ushered in a lot of this.
Oh, yeah. It's like he understood it.
Yeah.
And like when he saw, I mean, like they come to say, I mean, if you can even remember this, I can to an extent, you know, where they were talking about like just going to the movies.
Yeah.
You know, like you, and maybe some of you, a lot of us probably do. I still think like a lot of people who listen to our pods probably our age, you know.
Sure.
But, you know, like you didn't just save your ticket. You couldn't save a seat. You had to look in the newspaper for when it was coming on. You had to go there. You had to get in line and hope there would just be enough tickets and kids would be wrapped around the theater to go see. It was like it was an all evening affair.
Yeah.
Like you had to get there in plenty of time to stand in line to buy your ticket and hopefully go find however many seats y'all showed up together, because I can remember having to sit all over the place.
Yeah.
If like a group of us went, maybe two of us got to sit together down here, another random person's in the middle, two people. Like, there was no guarantee you were even going to get to sit next to the people you came to the movies with.
Mm-hmm.
And they saw dollar signs. Like, wait, these teenagers are, oh shit. All right. Let's cater to that.
Yeah, it's amazing how that has changed over the years, because
I'm
sure we've all heard those stories where you hear like the young kids, they go to the movies every weekend. They take that nickel and dime down to the Nickelodeon there and they go watch movies all day. You know, they just pay a nickel and they get all the movies they want.
Oh shit. Dude. We used to theater hop. We were those terrible people. We brought the newspaper clipping in with us and we would watch one movie and we'd stay back there and move into the next theater. Mm-hmm. And if it got too full, you'd keep moving so you didn't get caught. But you justified it by buying snacks all day because they're getting their money. You know what I mean? And we would do that like all Saturday. Like watch like three or four movies, pay for one, and just kind of know me. Like, how did none of the workers notice we were still there like 10 hours later is all I want to know. It's just like we're buying more popcorn, like, hi.
I mean, to be honest, back then I don't know, like you guys got pretty lucky. Today
everywhere.
No, today you could get away with, at least around here, like they don't seem to give a shit. You can just walk. Like, I feel like I've not tried it because I'm an honest person. But I genuinely feel like I could walk into the theater, my local theater, mind you. I some of them around here they're a lot better, but I feel like I walk into my local theater and just go into a theater.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
just
pick one and just walk right in, and they would never be the wiser.
Huh. No, there's always somebody standing at front. However, I think that's the reason why we could get away with it, because they were always just taking the tickets at the front.
Mm-hmm.
So once you've walked past there, there's nobody paying attention to which side you're actually going to. So you could easily just keep walking through them all. I think you probably still could, maybe a little.
Yeah.
Except for the whole saving seating will get you in a lot more trouble because you don't know if somebody has that seat saved. Whereas in the past, like, it was just finding a seat.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, so it might be a little harder now because people save their seats and I'm sorry. And just keep moving. Oh, I'm sorry. Until someone finally stops asking you to move. And they
hey, start from the back or start from the front. You know, a lot of people don't like sitting in the front. And then
I hate the front.
Once you, realize that, hey, everything's a little spaced out, you can kind of go to the bathroom and then come back and then just find you a new seat.
Hey, see, for somebody so honest, you got a good plan right there.
I can think of good stuff. It don't mean I'm going to do it. I'm just saying. We got
catering to kids in the movies is what we were talking about.
Mm. I mean, so Andrew McCarthy, kind of going back to him for a second, you know, he's one of the people in this group here.
Yeah.
And as we said, this is the documentary is kind of exploring what that term meant to a lot of them. Mm-hmm. I wish that there had been a moment where we could have seen all of them.
All of them, yeah.
But at the same time, I do understand why some did not talk to, and it wasn't anything personal. Keep that in mind, too. Andrew McCarthy made it very clear. It wasn't like they were just like, fuck you, we're talking to you about this stupid shit. The best way I can describe it is Anthony Michael Hall, who I would have loved to have heard.
Was
from
he
him.
Even considered a Brat Packer, though? Because they didn't even actually mention it, which was kind of shocking to me, because I thought he would have been mentioned, and he really wasn't.
I was curious about that, too, because I feel like he was, but
I would have considered him myself.
Yeah, but I heard an interview with him here recently on Fly on the Wall with Dana Carvey and David Spade.
Mm.
Do recall, he was the youngest Saturday Night Live cast member, which still blows my mind to this day, 17 years old.
Anthony Michael Hall was on Saturday Night Live as a cast member, not just like a host or something?
He was a cast member during that weird era between 80 and 85. He was with Downey, Robert Downey Jr.
I forget he was there too.
Two of them, like he brought Downey out with him. Which I did not know. Like, apparently he got courted by Lorne to be like, hey, I want you on the show. And he's like, okay, well, my buddy over here, he's pretty funny too. So can we just like bring him along?
Which I just can't picture.
It's weird.
I mean, he might be hilarious. It's just I've never really seen him do a straight up comedy role like that. Or I've just missed it.
It's not something you think about.
The closest, I guess, is Iron Man, because that had humor, of course. But like, I don't think of him as writing skits or improv skits or anything. Yeah,
it doesn't seem like that's his wheelhouse. Same with Anthony Michael Hall. It's a different type of comedy. Sketch comedy doesn't.
And your brain just has to work in such a different way. And it's not knocking one style over the other. But to be a really good improvisationalist, your brain is just working on a different level.
Yeah.
You're able to see things two or three steps ahead before you're even getting there. And it's just hats off to those who have that talent, because it's really amazing. Mm. Yeah.
So whatever got him there, he was talking to them and they asked, they said, you know, we saw McCarthy was doing this new documentary. He said, are you in it? And he's like, no. He's like, I turned it down. And they asked why. And he's like, really? Because I just don't want to look backwards. He's like, I don't care.
Interesting. Because I don't remember Andrew even mentioning it in the documentary, getting a hold of him. And he made it a big deal to kind of watch less him call or leave the messages for everyone else, you know? So that's when I went, well, maybe I was wrong. And then when they got kind of towards the end, not to jump ahead, but like where they were asking random people who you considered was in the Brat Pack, and to hear how some people just all had this different idea, it was kind of like, I guess none of us really settled on who it was officially, outside of probably like, you had to bring in Molly, you had to bring in Allie, you had to bring in Judd and Andrew. Cause it was like those four, I felt like we're maybe in more of them, or that's just how I remember it.
I think we get a lot of our wires crossed because, all right, so if I was to pick, like if you asked me who the Brat Pack were, my initial thoughts would go directly to St. Elmo's Fire and that cast. That is it.
St. Elmo's Fire and Breakfast Club is what pops in my head, those two.
Which would like, incorporate
pretty much
Anthony
them,
Michael right? Hall. You know, because the rest of them would have been just in St. Elmo's Fire, but then Anthony Michael Hall comes in with Breakfast Club. However, and I think this is why we didn't have...
And he was in Weird Science, too, right? He was
in Weird Science.
Was that John Hughes?
I think... Did he... He may have wrote it. I don't know if he directed it or not.
That's fair.
I can't remember.
But yeah.
But this is where I think why he didn't reach out to Anthony Michael Hall, because I can't remember. Maybe you do, if you can remember a connection. Did they ever have a movie together? Because I can't remember the two of them together in a movie.
Yeah.
They worked with the same people.
Sure.
But they were never together in a film. Therefore, if they didn't have that connection, then why would he call him? He may have been part of this group, but he did not know him. You know?
And interesting.
He may have. I mean, clearly he was reached out to because, again, Anthony Michael Hall said no. Okay. But if he didn't have a friendship with him like that, then it could have just been like a casual call. It's like, hey, I know you're kind of part of this whole thing. Would you want to? And it just didn't work out.
Interesting.
I don't know.
Yeah. I would have put him in it too, though, to be fair. I would have put Anthony Michael Hall. And honestly, when they were talking to John Cryer, I wouldn't have put him in it at all.
Right. Yeah. That
not even a little bit, because wasn't he only in that one? Or am I just forgetting shit? Because I feel like he wasn't in enough of them for me to, it would have never crossed my brain.
Pretty in Pink, right?
Ducky, right?
Yeah.
That's the only one I can think of. Maybe I should be looking this up.
No, but I think you're right.
I feel like he was only in one.
Well, think about it, because they were showing all these movie clips and stuff like that from all the other movies, but that's the only one for John Cryer.
And I forget about it because he looks so different now. Like it just, you know, like, let's see.
He's still rocking.
Yeah, it just says one Brat Pack movie.
Yeah. And well, it was kind of like what they said with Leah Thompson, because they were talking to her, and I was kind of surprised by that too. I was like, why are you talking to her? Like, she's not. She's not one of those actresses that I think of, Leah Thompson.
Yeah. Well, she even admitted in the doc, she's like, I'm adjacent, I guess. Like,
that's where I'd put John Cryer. You worked with these people, but
you were around when it was going on.
Yeah. You just weren't integrated into the group because you weren't in all these movies with these people and whatnot. So, I don't know. I feel like there is a core group people think of. Like, even Emilio Estevez, because I found this to be interesting, and kind of piggybacks off of what I was saying earlier, like, did not understand. And this is like my first inkling that the term was considered
not good. Yeah, yeah, they didn't care for it at all. Yeah.
So he
seemed very uncomfortable.
He did. He did. He seemed tense.
He did. Like, I felt like even when he was, well, that's probably what we're talking about. When Andrew, I think he was the first one he was able to interview, or at least put him first in the documentary. Mm-hmm. He just did not look like comfortable to be standing there talking about it at all. And it kind of made me wonder why he agreed to it then, since others had said no. He just felt, he did not look like he wanted to be there. And those two didn't seem like they had the most amazing chemistry to sit there and talk with either.
Yeah.
Because it seemed like, you know, when you start talking over each other like that, you kind of be like, oh, you don't know each other's rhythm or something.
See, there was a, I don't remember the time frame, so I'm just going to guess. 93, 94 season of Saturday Night Live, somewhere in there, he hosted.
Okay. Emilio?
Yeah. It was about the, it was around the time, and again, like this fucking helps, but maybe you remember this. Do you remember that one kid who vandalized some shit in Singapore and got the hell beat out of him, like they caned him as a punishment and everyone turned into a big deal?
I feel like I kind of remember something like that.
I can't remember his name. Michael Fay, I think that sounds right. I don't know. There was some kid who defaced some shit in Singapore. They busted him on it and said he's going to get caned. And everyone was like, no, that's cruel and unusual. And I was like, yeah, but the dumbass is in there. Country defacing shit. He has
Michael Fay.
Yeah, right. He needs to be punished by their rules. I mean, that's their rules, man. Sorry,
that's how it is there. Yeah.
Anyway, point being, that's the reason I can remember, because that was like the opening sketch that they did.
Oh, okay.
It was about the kid getting smacked,
caned
or whatever.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah. When he came out to do the monologue, I'm assuming this is his first time hosting, and he kind of was starting to talk about all this, and he's like, you know, and I hesitate to use the term, but I used to be part of the Brat Pack. And when I heard that, hesitate to use the term, I was like, I wonder why. Yeah, like, yeah, I never thought about it, but I always found it to be an odd thing that he said. I was like, I wonder why you would not want to, And then I just kind of shrugged it off, and I was like, well, whatever.
Yeah.
Now I know. Now I get it.
Yeah.
But even in that monologue bit, he listed, like, I guess people he would consider part of the group. So he mentioned Molly, he mentioned Judd, he mentioned Rob, which the Rob joke was pretty funny, because this is around the time that, I don't know if you remember the whole sex tape.
Rob's had a lot of controversies over the years.
Because he starts off, he's like, now, I'm sure we all know what happened to Rob Lowe in the last few years. And everyone's like, oh, and he's like, yep, he was in Wayne's World. And then just moves on. And I was like, good. That was good.
Nice. That was good. That was good. Yeah, you're right. Like, he's just taking all these movies now. That was so, independent films he's starring in.
Yeah.
Well, admittedly, like, as much as Rob Lowe and Demi Moore has done, I feel like they crossed out of the Brat Pack because I still need reminding that they were in it. Like, that's how I know they've done so much since then and have broken free of that term in my mind, that every time someone tells me Demi Moore's in it, I have to go, oh, yeah. Like, that's not the first thing that ever comes to my mind with her ever anymore.
Yeah, she's done, I mean, amazing work since.
Sure.
And
yeah,
I feel like Rob Lowe has kind of found himself in comedy. Like, he found that's a strength he's got, and he's really nailing it, man. So
I'm
glad that he, like, whatever it was about that just appealed to him, it just works. Like, it works for him, and I really like him in comedic roles and things like
that. I do too. Yeah,
but
we were talking about Emilio's interview.
I can't pinpoint why he, like you said, he said in that documentary that he didn't want to talk about it, didn't want to do all this, been avoiding all this shit. And then Andrew asked him point blank, why'd you say yes to me? And he's like, because you asked. And I was like, what the fuck does that mean? Like, everybody else, like, did too. But is it because it is him that's doing it? And even
or
still,
it was someone who was affected by it, maybe. Because I'm assuming all the people who were asking before were probably just like us, outsiders, journalists, things like that, who just wanted to talk about that era. And since it was somebody who lived it, suffered from it. All right. Yeah. I'll talk to somebody I can commiserate with, who understood, who, you know, and I think he probably harbors more guilt because he probably thinks it was kind of his fault. And I'm just maybe putting words in his mouth, but I could tell he just felt like this interview was supposed to be about something else. And then my interview wrecked all of us.
Yeah.
Not no one's fault. He had no idea what the journalist was going to say. Heck, the journalist, like even Demi said it the best, was probably just thinking he came up with something super clever here to get his next job.
Yeah, let's talk about that guy. You know, like
nobody was thinking.
Because he kind of did admit that up front, did he not?
They did get to talk to him. We'll say that. Like he talked to the guy who did the article in the documentary.
Yeah, and he seemed very okay with everything. Like he doesn't. I mean, he did say that there were maybe one or two things he kind of feels bad about, but overall.
But that he didn't know would have happened, though, like inadvertently, like after the fact, like, I didn't expect that. But
because, I mean, we're talking about, this would be no different than how we see all this clickbaity shit today. You know, back then, you know, journalists had to do something. They had to make something pop because you're publishing in a newspaper or magazine or what have you. Because this was New York Times, right?
I think it was some New York article
or Post
New York Times, something New York Post. Post is usually Garbo. Maybe it wasn't then. I don't know.
Maybe it wasn't them at all. It was an entirely different magazine. I can't remember. But yeah, he was writing for this newspaper, magazine, whatever, and doing.
It just said New York Magazine. So just
okay. Well, maybe it's
That's so generic.
New York.
That's why we couldn't think of it, because it's like it can't be just a New York magazine. But yeah, go. Anyway.
So I mean, he's doing this. He's trying to advance his career. He even admits as much. You know, I'm going to do this. I'm going to. This will lead to this and this and this and this and this.
Yeah. He's like, I'm 29, and this is what I did. And
And I'm glad that he brought it up, because honestly, I feel like we would have done the same thing, because. When he talked about coming up with the Brat Pack name, it sounded clever. It sounded catchy. Lauren Shuler Donner, who was one of the producers of two of the movies that they talked to, like he went out to her ranch and talked to her, and she said the same thing. When you saw it, because this is how I felt the entire my whole life. It was like, I thought it was an endearing term. Like they were just saying, you're the young kids. You're not the Brat Pack like, you know, Frank and his gang. You're the Brat Pack because you're the younger cool kids.
Yeah.
And I didn't see it meaning anything like that. And I'm so glad that there were other people who were like, no, I thought it was meant to be that.
Yeah, same though.
But then,
it didn't click to me about like it getting in the way of different roles.
Right. And that's,
unfortunately, people are like that. Like, I don't know why throughout all these years, they're actors, let them act. But for some reason, you're like, oh, he couldn't possibly. It's like, why though?
And that's the stupid fucking part about Hollywood back then. Why are you taking...
Even now.
Why are you looking at a fucking article from a newspaper and seeing this catchy little headline, Brat Pack? It's like, oh, well, I know who these people are. Have you not seen them act? Have you not seen what they can do? They've proven their worth. Mm-hmm. They've proven they know what they're doing. So this little article and this tag that they now have, that suddenly defines them, not their work? That's stupid.
And then I probably affecting sales or something, or, you know, maybe people won't want to go see them. I would imagine so, too, because, again, they were the it people to be casting at that time. I mean, if you look at how many of those films came out in a short period of time, I'm looking at 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. That's considered like Brat Pack movies in that 80s. Like, that's... It's a lot. Now, I know, you know, and guys, we were still using film. So, like, it wasn't like you could just digitally keep redoing things. You would run out of film and you'd have to go get more film before you could continue shooting for the day or whatever you did, you know? So, I don't know. I feel like that's kind of impressive in and of itself. They're full-length feature films, and I know we're not using CGI and all that kind of stuff, you know, but that makes it better.
Yeah, they just knock them out, man. Used to be able to do that.
About human people, like relatable human things, you know, like even watching 16 Candles, I can remember like, aw, you know, like just having this coming of age moment. And it was just, you know, it's fun to see.
And I feel like, as you kind of said, we kind of grew up as all this was happening or I can't.
Like, I don't remember the hubbaloo.
Yeah, like I don't either. I would say that around the time a lot of these movies were, like, I remember seeing them on the video store shelf or something like that. And I even, to some degree, remember when some of these movies were considered new, like they just came out.
Yeah.
But in hindsight, looking back on it, they've just always been there. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I don't remember, as you said, things just happening to me, like, oh yeah, this is the big Brat Pack stuff here. You know, it's just, I remember they were there.
Yeah, that was it.
And that's how it was. And I even remember, like, St. Elmo's Fire, I'll even give that one a good shout out. Like, I don't ever remember watching it as a kid, but...
No, not as a kid.
For whatever reason. And again, it could go back to my mother saw something in that story she connected with or whatever, but it was like something that she was just... I remember she was a fan of that film. Or at least that's how it came off. Yeah.
It's a good film, yeah.
So... I just remember that we had like a recorded copy off the television or whatever. And
sure. Yeah. As most of us did.
That's
what
we did back then, man.
That is what we did. Yeah.
But I honestly don't think I watched any of these movies until I was much older.
Oh, I was definitely in my teens. So it would have been in the 90s for sure.
Like you,
that I was watching these.
You pulled up a list of the movies. What are the movies they consider the Brat Pack movies?
Well, according to this Google, some of them even I was like, I don't know. But so St. Elmo's Fire, obviously. The Outsiders. I don't know if I would have considered that or not. But it has some of them in it. So fine. Maybe Rob Lowe counts or something. I don't know. Pretty in Pink.
Mm-hmm.
Breakfast Club. Mm-hmm. 16 Candles. Obviously, all those I would have put in there right away. One Crazy Summer, which looks like it has Demi Moore and
John Cusack. Yeah.
Weird Science, which I would have probably put there. A movie named Class, which I'll admit I don't know that I've seen, but I'm looking at the images and it looks familiar.
I think they talked about that in the movie, and they did. Same thing too. Like there was something about it that was like. Like I couldn't put my finger on.
Like was Andrew's character like into his mom or something? Like the scene that they showed, I was like, do I need to go back and see what that? I need context for that scene because the way they both looked at each other like they already knew each other.
Oh yeah,
I'm like, I mean, we did already have The Graduate, right? So I mean, it's
But
would they have been so daring to make the woman? I guess they did it in both. So whatever, we'll see. I have to go back and watch it now because I'm so curious for context for that one scene. I just have to know.
I mean, that looked like they knew each other. That was they that kind of look, you know.
That was the impression I got from the look they gave each other. Like, oh, shit. Maybe he didn't know it was his mom. But when they saw each other, like, oh, no.
Oh, damn.
My son's friend. My friend's mom. Oops. Nice to meet you, ma'am. You know, like, and then Fresh Horses has Molly Ringwald and Andrew McCarthy. About Last Night, which I would have put that in there, I think. Less Than Zero. This doesn't look familiar to me either, but Oxford Blues and Young Guns. Those are all the ones they put in there. Well, Young Guns, though, why though?
No, see, I wouldn't. No, just because it has Emilio Estevez? No.
Maybe. I think, yeah, it's just like, are you just pulling movies they were all in from the 80s? Elmo's Fire, Pretty in Pink, Breakfast Club, 16 Candles, and Weird Science. Absolutely in my head. Like, I feel like those I would have rattled off for sure.
Yeah.
The rest I'm not so sure about.
Okay, so I had to figure out what this movie was. So for a little context, the one we were talking
in
about, Class.
Yeah.
It says... A young man in private school spends one crazy night out, and only later does he learn more about the woman who enlivened his life.
So, okay, so it's what we think, probably.
Yeah, he probably went out, met this older woman. She just rocked his world, and then next thing you know, he's like, it's one night stand.
Wasn't his dad right there, too? Oh, the layers. I need to go watch this film now. I need to be like, what is happening?
Well, it says it's on Freevee and Tubi, so
okay.
There you go. Freebies.
There you go.
Ain't got to pay a dime.
Just have to put up some commercial.
There you go. Okay. Well, good on him for that.
Sure. You know?
Jacqueline Bisset. Shit, I haven't heard that name in forever.
No shit, yeah.
Wow. Why can't I think of words now? You know, this is where my brain is starting to
fail. I'm rubbing off on you, maybe. I'm sorry.
Wasn't she a... What do they call the shows that they show in the daytime with the people and the drama?
Lovers?
There you go. Thank you, Bubba. I couldn't remember.
It's hard to do, you know. don't see it though.
I don't remember
her stuff now. I don't know if she was or not. I was only a Days of Our Lives watcher. So,
well, maybe not. Maybe she was a Bond girl. That's what she was. Well, depends on how you define Bond girl, because she was in the original Casino Royale, which people would not consider the start of James Bond, because it was Peter Sellers as James Bond, and they were trying to do something. There's a whole thing.
There's a whole thing
with that movie. So she was just an actress. She was an actress. Maybe I was mistaking her name.
Well, it says she was. She replaced Mia Farrow in The Detective opposite Frank Sinatra.
Oh, Frankie maybe boy. Come on over here, doll.
Rat Pack. Look at it all coming around. Look
it's all coming around, baby. Circle.
Yeah. Anyway. But yes. Okay. What were we saying?
We were just
we were seeing what movies were considered in there. But yeah, so he did. He talked to Emilio. He looked very uncomfortable, very tense. I don't know. They didn't even look like they were comfortable chatting with each other. It was very awkward to me.
Which is weird, too, because when he got there, it seemed like, you know, hey, we're good buddies and everything. It's been a while, maybe, but then it just
30 years.
Like you said, got tense in the kitchen. It's like, why don't you two go sit down?
Right, I feel like that could have helped. Yeah, they're standing over this counter all awkwardly. And they were wearing the same shirt, which was kind of funny. Like, did you guys even think about that first? But then he moved on to Ally Sheedy.
Mm-hmm.
And she didn't seem to mind as much.
No, like she admitted to being some things that affected her, but she just kind of looked like she got over it. She's like,
yeah.
You know,
she's like,
is she even working today? Because that was
I think every once in a while.
I mean, I never want to assume that any of these people have retired. Like Andrew McCarthy, for example, when I found out he was working more behind the camera than in front of it, I was like, okay, well, so he's still active in the business, just not acting as much, which I kind of hate, you know, because I think I liked him.
He had a charm about him, you know, that it's just something about him. Because like, yeah, I remembered gravitating towards him. I don't know if I ever really like had a crush on him as a kid, but you would think so because I liked watching his flicks, you know, like he just did fun shit.
He seemed like, for me, he was one of those people I kind of wanted to hang out with. Like he seemed like the cool dude I just want to go hang out with. Like I wanted to be my buddy.
Yeah.
You know?
And by the way, I do always have to mention this now because when I, you know, was still serving tables at a place where right across the street from a convention center, he actually came in and ate. So I've seen him twice. He sat on our patio and he is a very lovely gentleman. Exactly what you would think. Very chatty, very. Yeah. He's everything you wished he would be. And it was awesome. So, so yeah, it's like you always get nervous. You never know, especially like you don't want to bother them. They're out. We never did. Obviously, we can't control what other guests do because they would be walking over there, of course, and trying to get pictures. Those who even knew who he was.
Sure.
There was a good chunk that was like, what's going on outside and why do people care about that guy in the corner? It's like, well, kids, pull up a chair.
Let me tell you
who he is. Yeah. Because when he had the conversation in the documentary with the kid when he was ordering the food, that's why I was just like, aw, you know, he's finally come to that where he's like, oh, yeah, we're doing a documentary. Kid has no clue who he's even talking to. He's like, well, have you ever heard of this, you know, the Brat Pack or whatever? And he's like, that sounds kind of familiar. You know, he just goes and sits and has his burger, nobody bothering him. And I'm like, aw.
That's sad, but I mean.
Gotta go talk to your mom. She might help you out. Or maybe your grandma. I don't know how old your mom is.
So Ally Sheedy is still acting. She's like did a show for like a year, I guess.
That Single Drunk Female. Yeah, I'm looking at that. I've never heard of it.
I'm blown away right here because I'm looking down a little ways and she was in one of the X-Men movies as a teacher. And I'm like, how the fuck did I miss that?
maybe they had her looking just enough different because if you're so used to seeing her with that short hair and kind of like the considered 80s goth makeup, you're like, oh, wait.
Yeah.
She looks a lot different than she did in those movies, you know, because she did have a look then with that specific kind of haircut and everything, which God love her. Somebody should have chose one that was a little more flattering for her because like as it got on, I was like, I know that was just the style in those days, but. I don't know. Longer hair on her looks nice. I shouldn't judge. You do what you want to do. But anyway.
She doesn't look like she's, I mean, obviously she has. You can tell she's aged, but she still looks like she doesn't.
I would see her and be like, oh,
yeah.
Ally Sheedy. Yeah.
Like, I still see Ally Sheedy. I don't see, oh, look at her. She's changed so much. I still see mm-hmm. that girl, mm-hmm. you know, from those mm-hmm. movies.
I do, too.
And I feel like the movie that I associate with her the most, weird as it may be, is Short Circuit. And I know that's that's not
huge one of hers. Yeah.
But it's a fun movie that I'm honestly really surprised that has not been remade in this day and age.
Give it time.
I'm sure, yeah.
Give it time.
Give it time.
We're making our way into the 80s now, so give it like another decade and we'll...
Good point.
We'll start getting there. But as soon as like they start trying to make like John Hughes films and stuff again, I'm like, I don't know that you could capture that same thing. I don't know that it would fly the same way. I don't know that we care as much. Because we all have content with us in it. We're putting ourselves in content out there. It's not like we're starved for finding teenagers.
Well, look at it like this, because John Hughes films, specifically that, I think I want to stick with that as the Breakfast Club type movies. Again, The Outsiders, that's that adjacent thing, you know?
I think so, too.
I would never consider that a Brat Pack film. But let's just say within the context of the John Hughes of it all.
Well, I guess it had two of them, Rob Lowe and Emilio. So maybe if they're considering two, Matt Dillon might be kind of on the cusp of a Brat Packer.
But see, that's like saying, it's a fucking Marx Brothers movie. You got Groucho and you got Harpo, but everybody else is gone. So is that really a Marx Brothers movie? No.
I agree. Yeah.
So anyway.
Yes.
I'm trying to remember where I was going with this. John Hughes.
You said the Breakfast Club movies, that we were just looking at John Hughes films.
Well, you were talking about remaking them. That's it.
Yeah.
So I feel like we do so many things in nostalgia when it comes to infusing movies with this John Hughes-esque sensibility about it or something like that, that remaking it almost feels like you're, I don't know, like something's just not going to hit the same way, because you're already taking these, like hollowing these movies out, and you're taking references, or you're taking, you know, the sensibility of it, and you're infusing it into these other movies to be like, it feels like that, doesn't it? It feels like a John Hughes movie, doesn't it? But then if you take the entire movie and say, now we're going to fucking just remake it, then what are you going to infuse it with? Because you've already kind of taken that and used that. So people be like, oh, this kind of feels Breakfast Club-ish, you know.
Or we're just trying to make a 21st century version of it, which what does that look like?
Yeah, it's not going to hit the same, because you cannot have that same, it won't hit.
Yeah, no, it won't. And I mean, especially with like technology and the way everything is today, I don't think you could have that same basically group therapy for an hour.
If they did want to do it, my best recommendation for anybody would be to, if you want the base core of that story, but you want to modernize it, take it, change it, do whatever you got to do to it, get your inspiration from it. Do not call it Breakfast Club. Do not have the same characters. Rework it in such a way that it hits what you're trying to do, but with a new sensibility about it. And it can talk to the audience you're trying to aim for, because you cannot do that movie today, because it's not talking to those same type of kids. Now, I'm not saying that kids today couldn't watch it and get something from it, but there is a different sensibility.
It would be much different archetypes too of kids,
100%.
You know, like, which we could make it your own, because kids are, well, I mean, every generation does its own thing, right? And now we're probably three generations past that, if you really want to think about it.
I don't know. I don't think that you can remake a John Hughes film. And I feel like the very first time they try it, which they may have, and I've forgotten. Nothing comes to mind. But
I can't
think. If they did try it, which it would be something big, like Home Alone. I know that's not his movie.
I kind of forget about it.
Directed, but he did write it. So I feel like that would be one of those movies that would be ripe for, well, they did it already. I forgot that Home Sweet Home Alone movie. See, that it shows how much right there we don't pay fucking attention.
I don't even think I knew about this.
Some movie they did for Disney Plus, and I heard it was just absolutely just like, I refused to watch it.
So good that I never heard of it.
Yeah, so good that you never heard of it. So clearly, at shows, and I was going to use that as a great example anyway, because once you go beyond the John Hughes of it all and start seeing other people, well, we're going to do Home Alone 4, and it's another kid, and here's Home Alone 5, but we're going back to the beginning. They don't hit. They don't work. You know, it's just, it's missing
and
something.
Something feels different about them, too. Because, like, I can remember at least watching, I think even when I watched Home Alone 2, we were kind of getting to the point where it was like, well, you know, like, how many times can we just leave this fucking kid, you know? And then when they got to the third one, I'm like, I think I'm done now.
Yeah.
Like, it's just the magic wasn't even the same, even when you had the same people.
Yeah. I mean,
you know? Yeah.
Well, that's a concept that shouldn't lend itself to a sequel.
Yeah.
Because like you said,
terrible parents.
Yeah.
How many times? just gonna leave this kid. You forget he's there. You know. And I mean, all of the nonsense that you had to write to make it even work.
Yeah.
Which, you know, it does. But again, you couldn't remake it now. Like they'd have internet. They'd probably be chipped at this point for kids. Yeah. Like we just, you don't lose them. You know.
And I think that's funny when we kind of look back on some movies are just of their time that remaking them becomes a nightmare because you're just like, well, what if because of this technology and then now that technology, like you'd really have to rethink how you approach it because it's just not going to work the same way.
It's not like a lot of horror films fall into that too. Cause it's just like, oh, we could just call the cops now with our cell phone, you know, whereas before it was just like, I just had to keep running in a field in the hopes that I'd find another human to help me out because there was none of that stuff, you know?
Yeah.
But anyway, documentary.
trying to think of some other people they talked to.
He did talk to John Cryer, which I think that was the reason why I thought it was a little strange, but maybe he was just having troubles because I was disappointed Molly didn't want to. I understand, but I kind of thought she would. I don't know.
Same.
I kind of thought she would because she's a big deal in that Brat Packer day, you know, and Judd Nelson. Which, by the way, that whole thing at the end was rude.
Oh, what? With Judd?
When he answers the phone and goes, Judd? And then it just ends. I'm like, wait, does that mean you did?
I'm going to assume that he said no. Because
I'm going to assume that, too.
If that's how you ended it, because the entire thing is he was trying to figure out where he was. Just couldn't get a hold of him. So it became a running gag. And then at the end, Judd? He finally got him. Maybe. And then just said no anyway, so it was like, fuck it. It turns into a bit for the movie.
I would have liked to have seen Judd and Molly, for sure. Like, I don't, you know. But he did talk to Rob Lowe, who was very Rob Lowe.
Yeah, I was like, so happy to see that, the energy coming off him, you know? Just a happy guy, man.
And I mean, things hit different for everybody. Because, I mean, the attention that was on Rob then is, you know, was probably a little different than the rest of them. Because he was definitely the hot one, the bad guy. You know, like the one they all swooned over. So he probably had a much different experience than like a lot of them did. But he just seemed to use like, but how cool it was. And that's what I enjoyed. Like, he was just this positive spin on it. He goes, but just how cool was it that we were a part of something like that, that's never been done before, never could be done in the same way again, right? Is just the golden age of movies were coming out. And then we were bumping into our own. He's like, and we were there. We were a part of it. We got to do it. And I'm just like, see, that's cool. But maybe something you can only look back with 40 years distance, you know, like, but he never really said about him having any issues that I guess earlier on in his career being affected by the name.
No, it didn't really seem like it hit him the same way. I mean, he just seemed like, it's whatever.
Or he's just moved so far past it now. He's just like, it's a whatever thing. It's a cool thing. We're memorialized together with this term, whether we all really hung out with each other or not. And fun.
And I don't mean anything bad about this or by it. But to maybe focus it on one thing, take a look at the two people who seem least affected by it that he actually talked to are probably two of the more successful out of the group. Again, I don't mean anything bad by it, but we're talking about Rob Lowe and Demi Moore seem like
they were able to push past.
Whatever. Like even the way Demi was kind of breaking it down, she's like, you know, you made it something negative. And
it did feel like therapy with Demi, didn't it? Like when he got there, she must have worked through this already. Oh, yeah. Like, yeah.
I would absolutely say that is 100% true. Like, she's giving him all the shit she worked through. She's like, mm-hmm. you internalized it. You made it negative. You're the one who's caused this, you know, pain.
He's like, goddamn, I was supposed to be miserating with you.
He listened, though, and he kind of took it. He wasn't like, no. He was like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. You're right. I did do that.
The perspective. Yeah.
And it was just, I'm hoping for when this, since it is out, obviously.
Right.
That maybe the ones who didn't want to talk about it would watch it, hear some of that, and maybe it helps them in some way. Like, for all the negativity that's just been kind of rattling around in their head about it, maybe they watch this whole thing and they internalize and go, you know what? Fuck it. I don't care. You're right. And then can just shed it.
Just shed it. I mean, how cool would it be if we could get them all back for, like, just a movie? I don't know. Like, it would be kind of funny, you know, just like, John Hughes, you got to come up with something.
Well, he can't do that from the grave.
Well, you should have thought of that then before
he should have. He should have
thought of it and left it in a safe somewhere for us to find.
He's got a manuscript sitting somewhere, and it's like, for the day when they all reunite. This is for you.
This is what it is. This is what it is.
Wouldn't that be something, though?
That would be, like, fucking cool.
Holy shit. Like, someone just unearthed some lost script from John Hughes and be like, my God, it's amazing. But it only works with the Breakfast Club group or the whole Brat Pack group.
And would it hit the same without John being the one there, too? Like, yeah. Giving them the freedom. Because, like, listening to them talk about getting to work with him, too, sounded great. Because it's like he wrote the script, as they said. But he's like, he wasn't married to most of it. Like, if you think this is going to work or whatever, he's like, let's try it. Let's do it. And gave them a lot of input on how they saw the character being able to be read on the screen. And probably so, even for being young like that. Like, people don't ask your opinion.
No. So
for that stuff, you know, like,
I could understand why that would seem appealing for young actors. Like Emilio said, it was like he wanted to know what I thought. And I just, that was great. You know, felt collaborative. So, and I wanted to ask you about this. Like, I don't want to, because John Hughes, that's a whole beast. You know,
oh, shoot. Its own pod in itself. Yeah.
But something you kind of said, you know, there are movies that he directed and then the movies that he wrote. Like, his fingerprints are all over a lot of 80s movies.
Sure. Whether
it's producing it, directing it, whatever, writing it, he's done a lot. Would you say, and I guess I'd really have to observe it, because I'm honestly trying to think about it, but can you say that you can identify maybe his movies regardless of whether he's directed it, or do you feel like that a movie that he wrote and directed or a movie he just wrote and someone else directed feels the same, or it lacks something, you know?
That's a good question. Because, like, a part of me wants to say it was the overall package that probably gave them some of those films, like, it's real magic.
Yeah.
You know? He wrote it, but he got to be there and let them... Would another director let them thrive in the same way?
Right.
See, give them that opportunity to, you know...
And I, like I said, I feel like we'd really have to go hard under our research and really try to see if we could.
I would have
it.
To analyze each film, I think, and see if I can really feel the differences with that in my head. You know?
And the only, like, I'm trying to remember just a handful. So let's use The Breakfast Club as a great example, because we know it directed it. We know it wrote it.
Yep. Yep.
And then move over to something like Uncle Buck. That's another book he wrote and directed.
Uh-huh.
There's something about it that I could believe they all existed together. Like, the sensibilities that are shot, the way it's acted, the way it looks, they feel cohesive as if John Hughes was putting them together. But then you bounce over to something like Home Alone, where he didn't direct it, but he wrote it. You feel the sensibilities, but at the same time, it's not quite the same.
Does feel a little different.
Like, I don't even know what to say it is specifically, but there's an element to that that you feel the John Hughes of it, but it's not there.
Do you think it has something to do with the fact, too, we don't have that real huge family element that we're, or a group element, an ensemble element throughout most of the movie? because I feel like he always nailed that ensemble, the people who could really work together, brought out the chemistry and the characters really well together. Home Alone, while we did have the family, the focus was him, the kid, and the two, you know, people trying to break into the home the whole time. So I'm wondering if, like, we had another one that he wrote and didn't direct that had an ensemble, if we would be able to tell a little bit more.
Not a bad observation. I had never thought about that. We may have to come back to John Hughes later, because I know we're going down.
Yeah, we might have to, because that would be an interesting dive. That would be, I think.
Because I feel like that some directors understand the material, some don't, and I can think of a few more while I'm sitting here, but I don't want to go down that hole just yet, because one specifically comes to mind that I think would be a great comparison to look at, but we'll get to it.
We'll get to it. Okay. Got to pin that for something later.
Yeah, we'll have to. Because I think there's something worth looking at there. But
oh, totally. Yeah. Just trying to think of, like, who else. Was that it? Was that it? Because I don't know that he.
I mean, I know that they talked to. I know there are a few authors and actors.
Yeah.
Or casting people from the backgrounds, you know, the people we weren't obviously looking at, but these are people who they had their information based on how they perceived it, because I know that the people who aren't there, how everyone else sees it, it's funny because a lot of them did kind of agree, you know, it was just like, well, it was just kind of a thing, you know, it was that's what it was. But we, as I guess the writers of whatever books that they did or screenplays, they were talking about how it defined a generation and you know, did all this for these kids, but they're not seeing it through their lens. They're seeing it through them as the writers and critics and directors and what have you. So it's
kind of how the outside people saw it.
Right. And I'm glad that we kind of had that, because as we said up front, you know, I didn't realize what it did to anybody. I thought it
never
was something
good. That.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But listening to him explain it, and as a young actor, oh man, I get it. You know, you're 21, 22, getting an article like that written about you, and you're legitimately trying to make, like, an honest career of it. I can see how that would mess with your head.
Sure.
Especially when the article kind of borderlined on not, like, being a good piece. It wasn't like a hit piece, but it wasn't like trying to fluff them up either.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
So yeah, from their perspective at being 22, 21, 22. Yeah, I could see that being kind of catastrophic feeling, you know, especially because you're so young and, you know, we're stupid still.
And I find it funny. And I was so glad to have a little context, because as you know, when I was a kid, you see actors and shit like that on TV getting interviews, and you just think, man, they're the coolest cats in the world. Mm-hmm. They ain't got a care in the world for shit. And then they showed that one clip of some interview. It was like, I think it was Judd Nelson and Andrew McCarthy, or it might have been Rob Lowe. I can't remember. But it was just they were at a premiere or a party or whatever. And he mentioned that he was like, a few drinks in, he was already this and that. But he showed that clip, and they're just, you saw this wave of self-doubt.
Oh, yeah.
And whatever it was, just kind of wash over his face. I'm like, what the fuck, dude?
Yeah.
You know, you should be living it up. And I would hope, if I was in that position, that I would just be like, woo, I'm, you know, king of the world right now. But I don't know. I could definitely be in that same position where I'm just like, oh, God.
Yeah. It's the type of career, too, that you're always going to be judging yourself, because you're always getting judged. You're always looking for a job. Always, always, always looking for a job. So something about that kind of work would mess with your head already anyway. What little bit I did sometimes would just, holy crap, as soon as one was done, I need to be auditioning and lining up the next one and the next one and the next one, because that could be it. This could be my last one.
Yeah.
And you never know what it's going to be. So that whole career is just, you got to be built different to be able to come out, I think, on the other side unscarred, if you even can. If you even can.
Or you're just lucky enough to have one that's not mired in controversy or drama or whatever.
Yeah. Back then, that was probably easier than now. We'll come up with stuff if we want. Now, we'll make it up.
Well, I'm sure that every single one of them would be canceled for one thing or another that they did way back when, even though that it was...
Weird Science, you think that would work?
Shit. Do you know how many people would be so pissed at that movie remade today?
You can't do that to women now.
Nope. They would find a way to flip it around.
Would we be allowed to do that either? Are we allowed to, are we in a day and age where we can objectify men? Is that allowed?
I mean, I think some women would think that, yes, they should be.
Well, I mean, so all of us will think something, right? Like, I'm sure a lot of dudes are being like, we can still objectify women. What are you talking about? You know, like, we shouldn't objectify anyone. But like, socially, what is it? Well, I don't know. I feel like we're allowed to do more to men than to women socially these days.
What if they did it and it was all about trying to teach the lesson about objectifying women?
Would it hit the same?
I don't
like,
know.
It'd be boring. Like a half an hour, like, you know,
like
industrial
woman,
film on how to not harass people or something.
You just have Kelly LeBrock coming out in her little half crop t-shirt and no, like super shorts and be like, listen, children, do not objectify this. You know, right. Let me tell you how hurtful this is. When you look at me, like, I know. I'm.
Yeah. She's probably like, whatever.
You fuck
know.
You.
But yeah, this is what I did. I don't know how they felt about it either, to be fair.
I don't know.
They might have hated it then also, but we were all just like, shut up. You're too sensitive. It's okay.
See, and I know that we're way off topic. We're probably done talking. Yeah.
But, well, and I was trying to look at the people here too to see, remember who all he interviewed.
But I think we hit most of them, you know?
I think we did.
Anybody
it was
who
only
was,
an hour and a half.
Yeah. And I feel like it would have been longer had he gotten Molly and Judd and even Andrew, Anthony Michael Hall.
Yeah, but see, I don't remember them mentioning him at all in the doc. That's why I just went, okay, I guess I was wrong because I thought I would have considered him part of it. But when he was never even mentioned, like even though they show Breakfast Club clips, like so we saw him in the movie, but I don't remember them dropping his name at all.
I don't either. I genuinely don't. He was asked, but again,
well,
why?
Yeah, I would have known had you not said he was on Conan or something, because like I didn't even catch that.
Beat the hell out of me. I don't know. I don't know why it felt like he got skirted, but.
Or like you said, was he really in that many? Well, I mean, two, if I'm looking at what Google considers Brat Pack movies.
And see, even still, that I feel like that would be a little unfair to just say, well, since he was in the Breakfast Club, then he's got to be part of it. But then he doesn't really officially feel like he is part of it.
Because, and he would be the only one in that group that isn't then.
Yeah. Even though for some reason it feels like he should be.
Yeah. It just does. Maybe that whole movie, I just feel like out of all of them, you know, maybe it's because it was such a small cast and we were just like focused on. I mean, it was really just five kids in a room the entire time.
Yeah. And funny
working
enough,
out emotions, like having group therapy, you know, and basically.
Funny enough, as you mentioned, you said that they have a list of 12, yet if you really pay attention to the movie or the documentary, Breakfast Club, St. Elmo's Fire.
16 Candles.
And 16 Candles seem to be the ones they focus on the most.
Same. Yeah, I'm looking at these and I'm trying to remember if they did they even mention Weird Science? I don't even know if that was mentioned. Class, they showed the clip.
Weird Science, I think, got a shout out, but it was a very because I remember there was a picture. I think it was of Anthony Michael Hall and Robert Downey
like
Jr. And whoever the other two were, whose name was it Matt Dillon? Was he one of them? In that movie?
See, that's where I was like, I'm getting him confused because he was in more than I thought, too. Like, I start looking at all these actors from when they were that much younger, and I'm like, oh, my God, I forgot how long you've been around.
Yeah. Doesn't matter.
I don't even know if I've seen the kid who played Wyatt again.
Yeah, he's one of those that I don't know if I can tell you who he is. But, yeah, it's just they seem to focus or seemed more focused on certain movies. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that was a point because of, you know, the actors that he actually got to talk to. But again, Andrew McCarthy
or the
wasn't
movies
in,
he was legit in.
Yeah, like he wasn't in the Breakfast Club.
No, he wasn't.
But I mean,
but you can't deny that flick. You just can't.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it's like you got half the cast. Well, not even half. You got two out of the five.
Yeah, I was just going to say Emilio and Allie.
Yeah. And then 16 Candles, he mm-hmm. was in, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That I think was, so. That was, what was his name? Blaine. Is that right?
Yeah. So he's some very, very upper white boy. it's very like what? Anthony Michael Hall, geek. Oh, yeah.
Geek.
That's just what he's named as, is geek on IMDb.
For Breakfast Club?
It's 16 Candles.
Oh, 16 Candles.
Just
oh.
geek.
Oh, so he wasn't. So they were in a movie together. Okay. But if he was just geek, then dude, that's a nobody.
Yeah, maybe
that's...
he was just like in the background or something. I'm not even seeing Andrew McCarthy on this. Did I click on the wrong thing?
Wait a minute. Pretty in Pink. Wait.
Pretty. Oh,
that's,
yes.
That's okay.
Jesus. I was flipping him.
Sorry.
No, me too, though. Me too. Yes. So
Pretty
he was
in Pink
not in
was,
that one.
Okay. So that's
Andrew
why
McCarthy. Yeah. But that was fun to watch, though, too, where they said they had to reshoot the ending.
Yeah. What about that? Jesus Christ.
Mean, honestly, like, with me looking back on it, I could see why everyone was booing. I mean, like, really? After this whole thing, that's who you're going to have her go off with, you know? And apparently the people in the theater were just like, boo. She just went out there with John Cryer's character, Ducky, and they danced. And apparently it just ended and it was over. And the audience was not having that. And so they brought them back for a day to reshoot the film. And it's hilarious. Now I can't not see it.
Yeah.
The wig. Because Andrew McCarthy said, we were done. I was doing a play. I had already shaved my head and they had to bring him back and they put this wig on him. And as he said, if they knew we were going to talk about this movie 30 years later, they probably would have sprung for a better wig.
Sure.
But just to come back and say that line, basically, and I've always loved you or whatever it was, and then walk off, you know, and I'm just like, but still,
just,
I don't know. I liked it.
Yeah. No, it's interesting. Like, I didn't know that there was an alternate ending. I just thought that was how it was. And
yeah, test audiences were like, hell no, we're not doing that. Mm-mm. So thank you guys,
sure,
whoever tested it, you know, because I think I would have been angry at that ending also.
I mean, you know, they tried something different. They were trying to be like, hey, look at the thing that we did.
Right? Nobody figured they were paying that much attention. Oh my God, I forgot Andrew Dice Clay. I'm just looking at it now as the bouncer.
Yeah. That guy.
Annie Potts. Ah! See, I'm just looking at all these names going, oh my God, you guys.
She's such a delight.
She really Annie Potts. Is.
I don't think I've ever seen her in something I didn't like her in.
Yeah, she's just always been great. Yeah. You still gotta watch Hacks. Because like now I'm thinking of Designing Women and like all that kind of stuff.
Designing Women, there's a show we ought to talk about. Damn.
That was another good one. But yeah, People. I don't know. I love her so much. That show is so great. So People also say that now. If you've got HBO, go watch Hacks. It's freaking glorious.
I need it's one I've wanted to go and watch because I love Jean Smart. I think she's just
Yes. She kills it.
Yeah. I don't know what it is about her, but there was a point in time where I remember her just being the dunce from Designing Women.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And then suddenly I saw her in a movie and I was like, oh, my goodness. Like, she, my heart be still, because I was like, I've got a big crush on her and I have ever since. I don't know what it is.
I don't
but
blame
boy,
you.
She was, whoo.
No, she's a good looking woman. She still is.
Yeah,
still
that's
is.
What I'm talking about.
I can't
about.
Believe she's
insane.
70 is what they were saying. And I was like, really? I'd give her 60s for sure, but like 70, sure. I was like, all right, you go, woman. You got it good. Anyway, I know we're deviating, but well, what is your favorite of those films then?
I think I would really have to go with The Breakfast Club. I think that it tells such a solid story. It's entertaining. It can be deep, but it also kind of lighthearted in sensibilities about it too. And I'm not saying that the others are not good, but
right.
I think that's the one I can connect with a little bit more. Like, there's something about the characters. Like they said, you know, there's an archetype for everybody almost. So you can relate to somebody. And I guess I would probably say that I relate Anthony Michael Hall's character.
Anthony Michael Hall.
As the
geek.
Because I feel like Judd Nelson's character, while that kind of would feel like some element, like I could see a little bit of Bender in me, it's not mm-hmm. who I was. You know yeah. what I mean? And I definitely
like the hard-ass guy that tried to scare everybody.
Yeah, like those people I didn't like.
Yeah.
And I definitely wasn't a jock. Mm-hmm. So he being the geek, yeah, as me.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I can own that. So.
Sure. Fair. And nowadays, I think it's cool.
Sure.
I think we're allowed to say geek and nerd now, and it doesn't mean the same as it did then. Or maybe it's a slur now. I don't know. You kids are just going to have to tell me because y'all change shit so fast. I don't know if what I'm saying is offensive or not anymore.
We're going to go down one more rabbit hole before we're done.
Sure, let's do it.
Did you happen to see that video of some lady? I don't even know what the fuck she was mad about. I really don't.
Mm-hmm.
But she just... All these nerds with their nerd money. They've got all this money now, and all the nerds are just taking over, and they're trying to change everything and just go back to your holes, you nerds. And I was like, who the fuck are you, and what decade did you come from?
I don't remember this.
She, if I'm not mistaken, this is the same woman who got busted for dropping an N-bomb just casually.
Oh, just like recently?
Yeah.
That just like made her conservative news circuit because we got her popular by complaining about her? Yeah. Mm-hmm. I remember that one. I don't remember the other one.
I think it was the same woman. But she's just like, can you imagine all these fucking nerds? And it was like, who are you? Like, what are you mad at? I don't understand right? what you're mad at right now.
And we have all of this really cool stuff because of those nerds. So,
but they're controlling everything now.
They really are, though. They own Silicon Valley, for sure.
I don't know.
I mean, it's true. If you look at the tech guys, you're like, yep, they got shoved in a few lockers in high school. You know? You could see it. It happened. That's probably why they're so smart. But I would have to agree with you, though. I feel like the Breakfast Club out of all of them is the one that, like, I'll gravitate towards and watch over and over and over.
Sure.
You know, and it's just as fun for me. Although I don't know that I really could relate. Because, like, I don't think I was really that big of a weirdo.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if we're talking between, you know, the two female leads or whatever. And I was definitely not, like, the prissy popular chick that sure. everyone wanted to get with. So it was just a fun movie from my perspective.
But you couldn't see, like, even maybe, elements of one or the other, like both of them combined would be you somewhere in the
maybe
middle?
Maybe a little Allie, because I did feel like kind of an outcast at my school, even at mine, if you could believe it or not, you know, and always being like the theater kid. We were always with like all of the nerdy kids because we were always just that loud group that was over dramatic or something, you know? And then maybe some other people. I remember getting somebody told me I looked like a young Molly Ringwald once, and I was like, really though? Okay.
Yeah.
I don't see that at all. So maybe that's the closest I could say to relating to her is I had some dude on a train say I looked like a young Molly Ringwald once, and I didn't even have red hair at the time.
Thanks, I guess.
I mean, sure. I mean, we look nothing alike.
No,
right?
I don't see it at all.
Like, I get it even now, but, like, I don't look that much different now than I did as a kid. Obviously, there's more wrinkles and crap, and my hair wasn't blue. But, that one threw me. I was just like, really? Never heard it again.
I've seen other actresses that I would say that remind me of you more. I couldn't tell you their names off the top of my head, but
I always got Allie Larder, and it made sense. Because we both have like longer faces, blonde. I feel like our face shape was at least the same. So I could see when I got that one more than once. Mm. That one I'm like, all right.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't like her necessarily, but I could see why you think we look like each other, you know? But then that's it. I don't know that somebody else told me about someone else, but I can't remember it now. They'd have to send me the picture again.
Yeah. I know I've seen one or two that I'm just like, when I see how they act or just certain ways they say or do things, I'm just like, it kind of reminds me. And they have certain similar facial features. So I'm just like, that's cool.
I did try to put on lipstick with my boobs once. Does that count? After I watched the movie, where I was just like, can you?
Can you?
No, no. Mine's, and I'm sorry. Hers, she's smaller than I am even. And I don't know how she managed it. So good on you. Because that's a way I can't contort. I just saw it in the movie. I'm like, well, Why not try? No, no, no. Only chips will get stuck in there. That's all. potato chips are a fun snack. Anyway, yes. So yeah.
The doc, though.
I learned a lot. I really didn't know that all of that was surrounding or just like this dark cloud over a lot of their heads for all of these years. And yeah, I kind of feel bad about it.
Yeah, I never knew, and I hate that they've gone through this, but I like I said, my hope is that they watch this doc and maybe find some closure, if they haven't already. Whatever, it's been demonizing them all their lives, just throw it away, man. Just wait off your back, be done with it.
Yeah, and maybe Molly has, and that's why she didn't want to. She's like, I've already worked through my shit with it, and I've moved on, and I'd like to keep going forward.
And I feel like she did write an essay or a book or something. I know one. Maybe he did. Andrew McCarthy. I'm pretty sure he wrote a book as well.
You're probably right. I feel like all these people write books and I just miss it. Yeah. Every actor's got some book they wrote about. And I also didn't know that Demi was having so many troubles like that early on either. Like, I didn't know that they had a sober coach for her on that movie. I was just like, how old was she?
Yeah, that was like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Very young. So, yeah. So, I think it was for which they were filming About Last Night, right? That was where yeah. And that was funny when they were like, well, what do you care about, your health or your career? She's like, I was 21. I'm like, my career?
Yeah.
Like, no, I don't want to go to rehab. I want to go shoot the movie, you know? Yeah. And so, and they paid for her to have a sober coach. I like, no idea. Why would I? But like, I feel like I would have heard about that over the years.
Yeah, I've never heard that story or even anything remotely close to that. So that's just like, holy shit.
I mean, I knew she had some like addiction issues later on in life, but I figured that just bred from all the people treating her like crap.
Yeah.
Because unfortunately.
This is what we do.
Yeah, yeah. She just did not, you know, get treated very kindly through all of it. So I thought it was something that had developed, not something that she kind of like came into films with already. Good honor, though. I would have had no clue. She got through it. Dalton's good, you know. Like, but, yeah.
My only hope, and I know this is a big, big hope, outside of them just all putting it behind them, I would love to see them all together. One more time.
Not on Donahue.
Yeah,
which did that bring back some memories? You're like, oh, man, Donahue. I forgot about Donahue.
Yeah, it's... That is a talk show that I haven't thought about in a long time, and then seeing that white-haired fucker, it was just like, there he is. I'm
like, oh yeah, there you are. And they were trying to be nice about it, you know, like, oh, do they like this term? And they're like, no.
And then there was even that film critic or writer or something up there with him, and he's just like, it's terrible. They shouldn't have been.
Yeah,
I was just like, who the fuck are you? You did the same thing. Yeah.
No, he wouldn't have. He would have taken the high road. That's why he was speaking up on Donahue.
I don't know. I think this is a interesting documentary, especially if you are at all interested about these people or if you're a fan. This will definitely just, I think it'll blow your mind if you weren't familiar with some of these stories. I think, for the most part, I don't know how much of this stuff has already been public knowledge or...
Oh, yeah. Like, if it's been out there, I didn't know.
Yeah. From some of the more personal details, like you said, like the Demi stuff and all that stuff, it was news to me.
But to be fair, I don't usually like stalk an actor's life. Right. I'm usually cool with them making their entertainment on the film, and then I walk away. And then if I happen to hear more about your personal life, it was completely on accident.
Sure.
like I've learned more about some celebrities than I ever wish I knew, you know, and that's stay off Twitter and I'll quit learning all of that about you. It's like, I didn't need you to ruin that film for me that I used to like. I don't.
Yeah.
Pretend like you're not a human.
There's one actor. I'm not going to drop his name right off hand because I know that there might be
fans,
drama, whatever. But I really like this actor. I really do. And I love everything that I've seen him in. And then yet when I see him on Twitter and he's saying certain things, I'm like, dude.
Yeah.
So having to try and compartmentalize, I love your acting.
It's hard to do.
Yeah, your personal stuff is just, we're not, I don't know if we could be pals. Maybe we could. Yeah. We just couldn't talk about that shit.
Right. We would have to talk about all sorts of other things. But and I think
yeah. that's a good mindset to have, you know, if you can find a way to get along without all that
shit should in the be, middle. Yeah. Just keep finding the common ground. And then when you find it, let's pull on that thread instead of yelling at each other for, I don't know, why we think I'm so much smarter than you. Because if you don't believe what I believe, then you're a dumbass. What?
I mean, that's how I've tried to approach certain people at work. You know, I know that I would almost bet that
you're probably a lone wolf.
Yeah, you're a lot of these people are going to have opinions that I do not agree with at all. But you know what? I can be nice. Yeah. I can just be courteous and I didn't got to be mean.
We've all brought up something different. All of our lives, a little bit different, around different people, with different upbringing. We're going to have a different idea about what the world looks like.
And, you know, that's a great metaphor for this group right here. You know,
true.
Might be why getting back together just wasn't all for them. You know, they're just like, yeah, whatever.
And if you find out they never really were friends in the first place, it kind of makes sense. They're just like, we just worked on a few films together. Like, we hung out at the after parties and then we went on our lives.
Yeah, this isn't like the Friends cast where it was like 10 years right. working together side by side. Yeah, it's going to be rough.
Oh, yeah. If they did TV together for that long, I would maybe, you know. But yeah. I mean, how long these take? A month, 6 weeks, 2 months maybe to film? I can't imagine they took that long. No. These movies that they did together.
Oh, yeah. That could be a couple of months and then they're done.
Yeah. And then they're done. Yeah. So then and then you move on to your next gig and then so on and so forth. It's not like these movies that take like 6 months to a year to film now, you know. So, yeah, if I hadn't used any common sense to think about it, I'd probably have been like, yeah, why would they have known each other really outside of there? But we just assumed because they got connected by this term that they had nothing to do with.
Right.
Anyway. So crazy to think about. Yeah. So I don't know. I liked it. So.
I did too. I recommend it if you're at all curious about either them or just even that time in Hollywood altogether. I think that's it kind of explores a few little details here and there. So,
and just to catch up with Andrew McCarthy.
Yeah. What a charming, great guy.
I would love to sit down with him for a day and just chat. He just seems like, I got shit to say. Let's have a conversation. And he looks like he's the type to want to like listen and learn too from other people. So it just would be a fun afternoon. Yeah. Maybe if I ever wait tables again and he comes in, I'll just have to sit down and be like, look, I saw you in the documentary and now we're friends. So you're going to talk to me.
Well, if you pull that off, I want in on that. I'll run up there.
I'll let you know if I'm not in jail. Yeah.
Siblings. Have you watched this documentary yet? Is it something on your list? Did you not even know about it?
Right.
It's a very real possibility.
Yeah.
Let us know on social media at Super Mega Crash. Let us know what your thoughts about it were, what you learned, what you didn't, what you knew, whatever it is. Let us know.
What was your favorite of the movies?
Yeah. What was your favorite Brat Pack movie?
Now I feel bad using the term, but like it is what it is now. It's in our culture. It's what it is.
See, we didn't even talk about the Brat Pack meeting the Rat Pack story.
I kept thinking about it, then we'd move on and I'd forget. But yeah, they were that's kind of fun.
Yeah.
To just be like sitting at an after party and they're like, you want to go have drinks with Sammy? And he's like, yeah, we're going to have drinks with Sammy. Why wouldn't we go have drinks with Sammy Davis
Jr.? Yeah. I'm gonna say no. Fuck you. Right. Come on.
Yeah. So like Andrew and Rob Lowe go with the Brat Pack and the Rat Pack having drinks.
With Liza Minnelli of all people.
You know, like, yeah. Like, come on, guys. That's such a crazy story.
I wish I'd have been there that night.
Hell yeah. I'd get in trouble for stalking, probably, though. You know, you're like, but I want to come to Sammy's house, too.
Please.
I like Rob Lowe.
send us an email at supermancrash@gmail.com. Follow us on Patreon. Chuck in a buck if you would be so inclined. Leave us a 5-star review on your favorite podcasting app and keep up with any and all things over at pencilpaperproductions.com/supermancrash. Make sure the show
notes. Backwards.
It was bound to happen one day.
One day.
I got through 40 some odd episodes before it happened, so I did good. Join us again next week, siblings. But until then, go beyond your limits.
This has been a Pencil and Paper Podcast Network production.